Some questions about this patient to consider would be, what is the prognosis for the patient given his molecular status and his comorbidities, and how do we evaluate those sort of independently of one another, but then taken together to make a decision for the patient? So I think the molecular status is probably the lower hanging fruit. It's sort of easier to look at those data objectively. Well, how would you prognosticate this patient?
So from the FISH perspective, we don't have any abnormalities. So that's more of a neutral kind of prognosis. The IGV is unmutated. And again, like we saw in previous cases, that is classically more of a poorer prognosis.
Assuming we were going to give chemo.
Exactly.
Okay. I didn't mention that whether or not this patient had next generation sequencing performed. I think it is important to always make sure that that testing is performed. We'll probably see many patients in the context of our careers where that's not always a standard. Should be added on before treatment decision making.
And I agree with that. I think at a minimum, a TP53 mutation study should be done.
Agree, and that's what I meant.
In all patients.
Totally agree with you. What about the tougher question of assessing prognosis based on other comorbid conditions? And I'm curious whether we, as a group, lean more towards using models like assessing a Sears score, or whether or not we are more clinical gut impressionists, and how do we do that in practice? Because certainly the clinical trials tell us that we should be calculating a Sears score. If it's greater than or equal to 6, we do this. Or, you know, in practice, are we sitting around with calculators, calculating a score and then making a decision? You can tell by my sarcasm that I'm not, so right. I'm curious what others
I think
are
the
doing.
Germans has done a great job in using a very standardized way to look at the patient's comorbid conditions. So they're using the SEER score, which is a cumulative illness rating scale, which are looking at different systems. I think it's 13 different systems.
But for
the severity of each system's disease, you can rate from 0 to 4, and then you add all the points together. So the highest point will be 56 points. So for clinical trials, I think it's important to use a standard that everybody can follow. In fact, all of the German clinical trials, large randomized frontline CLL clinical trials, had used a SEER score. For example, CLL 11 study used SEER score of greater than 6 as a defining patient who has significant comorbid condition. In real life practice, I think it's pretty difficult to look at that, and most of us, I believe, is using more of our clinical judgment.
Yeah, I agree. I think the SEER score is generally reserved for patients who get on a clinical trial. On patients in routine practice, I think all of us use our quote unquote the eyeball test as how good a patient looks. I think certainly some objective criteria are essential. So for example, we need to know what the patient's creatinine clearance is, et cetera, to be able to make sure that we do not think about, for example, venetoclax-based treatment options in patients that have a creatinine clearance that's low, that the patient can get into trouble. And so I think in general practice, I don't think the SEER score is that important to be done, but ideally it should be followed in a clinical trial.
So one question I have is about age. You know, CLL is a relative diagnosis of the elderly, average age 70 to 71 at diagnosis. How do you define advanced age in your CLL cohorts, and does that have any influence in your treatment decision making outside of comorbidities?
So I think age greater than 80, at least in my mind, I think of those patients a little bit differently. There were initial data from The Ohio State University where they published their initial experience of approximately 300 patients where age greater than 80 was an independent predictor of patients having the need to stop treatment or dose reduce more than the usual. And that was mostly because of tolerability, because of a number of side effects that those patients had. And so in some of our patients who are older than 80, where we think about starting ibrutinib, we might start at a slightly lower dose and then ramp up if they're able to tolerate the lower dose of ibrutinib.
I think the absolute age is important, but it's also the physiologic age is important too. So like I said, as we already talked about, we need to look at the patient as a whole to look at all of the other medical conditions in addition to the actual age.